أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praises due to Allah. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, His household, His companions, and everyone following Him until the Day of Judgment. اللهم آمين. We continue with our Tafsir sessions, and we are still with Surah Adh-Dhariyat. Surah Adh-Dhariyat, Surah number 51. And today we are with verses 24 onwards, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Allah Azza wa Jal, in this part of the Surah, talks about the story of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. As we mentioned many times before, this Surah is Makki revelation. And Makki revelation before the migration of Rasulullah SAW has certain qualities and attributes. One of those qualities is talking about the nations before, to get the lesson, to say to Rasulullah, to the Sahaba at that time who were weak, persecuted, and minority, that you are not alone, this happened to the people before. Also telling Rasulullah SAW that you are not alone, prophets also suffered before you in a certain way. And in here, just talking about Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Sayyidina Lut alayhi salam. Then it will talk about Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam later on. Sayyidina Ibrahim and Sayyidina Musa, or Sayyidina Nuh, those are from Ulul Azmi min al-Rusul, يعني the prophets of the strong resolve and will. Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, Sayyidina Muhammad alayhi afdalu salati wa atammu taslim. Five of them. So here Allah Azza wa Jal talking about one aspect of the story of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. هل أتاك حديث ضيف إبراهيم المكرمين إذ دخلوا عليه فقالوا سلاما قال سلام قوم منكرون فراغ إلى أهله فجاء بعجل سمين فقربه إليهم قال ألا تأكلون فأوجس منهم خيفة قالوا لا تخف وبشروه بغلام عليم فأقبلت امرأته في صرة فصكت وجهها وقالت عجوز عقيم قالوا كذلك قال ربك إنه الحكيم العليم. This is like half of the story. Allah عز وجل saying to رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, هل أتاك حديث ضيف إبراهيم؟ Did it reach you? هل? It's a question article. Ataka from ata means it came to you. Did it come to you? Means, do you know the story? Of course, he did not know, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is a way of tashweeq or suspense, like creating some kind of emotional desire to know what it is. Like, hal ataka hadithul ghashiyah, about the future, about the day of judgment. Hal ata ala al insani heenu min addahan lam yakun shay'an maskura. Is it, you know, did it occur to you? Did it happen? Did it reach you? So, هل أتاك, to talk to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. حديث ضيف. The word ضيف can be singular, one ضيف, one guest. Or those two people are my ضيف too. Or this group of people can be my ضيف. And this is the one of the adjectives in Arabic language that can be singular, but it can describe any number of people, male or female, group, 2, 3, 4, 10, 100,000, doesn't matter. So, Daif Ibrahim al-Mukramin. They are the Daif of Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Israelites and some of the narrations say that they were 12 angels. 12 angels. Or this, some of the narrations said they were 9 and number 10 was Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam. Some narration says there were 3. Jibreel alayhi salam, Mikael alayhi salam, and Israfil alayhi salam. And they are daif because they came as guests. They came look like humans, very handsome young humans. And there is a purpose for that we'll discuss later. So they are mukramun, means they are honored. That is referring to Sayyidina Ibrahim. It is a description for the guests, but indirectly it is a description for the host. When you say the honored guests, who honor them? The host. Or the guests who are the happy guests, means the host, it make them happy. So they are mukramun. Also, it refers to their characteristic because the angels, Allah Azza wa Jal says, بَلْ عِبَادٌ مُكْرَمُونَ, they are honored from the honor that one inherently has. So Allah give them this honor, takreem. So it can be because they were taken care of as guests, or it can be their description as an angels. Like وَإِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ كِرَامًا. They are كِرَامًا كَاتِبِينَ. They are honored. A status, you know. So it can be either or. إِذْ دَخَلُوا عَلَيْهِ فَقَالُوا سَلَامًا. إِذْ دَخَلُوا عَلَيْهِ فَقَالُوا سَلَامًا. They came and they give salam. طبعا this story, it is coming here after talking about the disbelievers and how they deny the hereafter, and how they challenge Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So it is more of consoling Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, giving him solace, like, you know, you're the not the only one. Story of Sayyidina Ibrahim mentioned, of course, in Quran many times. So they, when they came, قالوا سلاما, like السلام عليكم. قال السلام, سلام, سلام also back to you. قوم منكرون, قوم منكرون. يعني you are people that I do not know. يعني I do not know. You are not from here. Like, you know, when you say وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته, are you new in town? Something like that. You know, like, I don't know you. قال سلام قوم منكرون means I don't know you. You are not known to me. فقال سلام قوم منكرون, and they were like people, as I said, they are handsome and they are young and all of that. سلام قالوا سلاما قال سلام. You know, سلام means it's better than سلاما. When somebody said سلاما and you say سلام, so Dhamma is higher than Fatha. So that's also, he replied in a more generous way. فراغ إلى أهله. So he make them enter and feel comfortable, like anybody would do to his honored guests. فراغ إلى أهله means he went to his wife and to his family. فجاء بعجل سمين. He slaughtered a calf, fat calf. سمين here means full of meat and fat and all that. That was something as a sign for generosity, like you give your guests the best that you have. And he barbecued it, or he cooked it. In another surah, فَجَاءَ بِعِجْلٍ حَنِيذٍ. And حَنِيذٍ here means it is cooked in the heat of the sand. So they, and it's until now, it is a known dish in Yemen. And in Yemeni restaurant you go, they have the lahm al-hanith. You tell him, I need the meat of hanith. Hanith, they dig a hole in the ground, and then they build it, now with cement and everything, or they put a barrel in there, and the fire comes from under, and then they put the pot or of rice and food and everything. So rice, and then they put the meat on the you know, rods. And then after that, they cover it and seal it and put the sand over it and make sure that it is done. So they leave it like overnight or a day or something like that. So to cook. So it comes, mashallah, يعني, something. I'm sure I make everybody hungry now. So it comes very nice. So this hanith. So Ibrahim alayhi salam cooked that. That is, someone might ask and say, but didn't take long time. The answer can be, that was the habit of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Allah sent him the angels at the time that thing was ready. Like, he's already cooking these things. And that is another proof that Sayyidina Ibrahim was generous by nature. Generous by nature. He cooks like that all the time, expecting guests. So Allah sent him the guests at that time. So it shouldn't be something strange or anything like that, that he said, oh, it took a long time or so. So he brought it for them, the whole ijl, the whole calf, cooked and put it in front of them. Surah Hud said, فما لبث أن جاء بعجل حنيذ, يعني he brought it quickly. Some also say that الحنيذ means the meat that it is done over heated stones. Like stones, they put it in the fire, like those lava stones, like the smooth ones. So they put it in the fire, then they put it, and then they put the steak or the meat over it. So they cook it that way as well. So either or, he brought them the best that he has, alayhi salam. And Sayyidina Ibrahim had like lots of cows and all that cattle, like livestock. That's why he brought from them. And قال ألا تأكلون, please eat. Why you are not eating? Like, you know, someone like a guest, and he eat little bit, or he does not eat. He said, why you are not eating? Eat. And you put the stuff in front of them. قال ألا تأكلون. وأيضا also he became scared, because at that time, if people do not eat your food, means they have bad intention. They are coming here for something. Because, you know, the old times, and especially in the Arabs after that, and they are the offspring of Sayyidina Ibrahim, they had these characteristics as well. So if you eat somebody's food, even if you intend to harm them, you don't. Because, you know, basically, it becomes like very low thing to do, very low thing to do, that you eat my food and then you hurt me. So that's why it's either you're not going to eat my food and hurt me, or if you eat my food, you're not going to hurt me. So that's why he thought that they are not eating his food, because there is something. So that's why in Surah Hud, verse 70, says, أَوْجَسَ مِنْهُمْ خِيفَةً, he was scared of them. قَالُوا لَا تَخَفْ, يعني in Surah Hud says, don't be afraid. We did not come to hurt you. They came actually for Qawm Lut. Lut was the nephew of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, and he was sent to Sodom and Gomorrah, the people who have this homosexuality, men with men, and they do that. And Allah talk about them in Surah Al-Ankabut, Surah Al-Shu'ara, Surah Hud, Surah Al-A'raf, different surahs, you know, about the sin that they do. So they came to destroy them, and they were coming with the punishment. But in their way, they passed by Sayyidina Ibrahim to give him the glad tiding of Ishaq. At that time, Ismail was born already 10-15 years before, and he's in Mecca now. Okay, so that is the one. But now, Sarah was infertile. She does not. That's why Sayyidina Ibrahim had Hagar, and had Ismail from her, because his wife doesn't give birth. So now the wife also will give birth. So they go to Qawm Lut, and in their way, they give the glad tiding of Ishaq. So when they did not eat, he said, then ما خطبكم, يعني what is the deal here? What is the deal here? Before that, they told him, don't worry, we are not here to hurt you or anything. We are not eating because we are angels. Angels don't eat. So now they introduce themselves. And then they told him, وَبَشَّرُوهُ بِغُلَامٍ عَلِيمٍ. So they give him that tiding with a knowledgeable son. Subhanallah, if somebody goes and check in the gender of the baby, they said, oh, you know, your wife is pregnant with a son. Everybody becomes extremely happy. But can you imagine if there is a way to tell you what kind of son it's going to be? This is only for Allah Azza wa Jalla. So that's why when Allah says, Allah knows what is in the wombs, nobody can come and say it is the gender only. No, Allah knows how they're going to live, or they're going to die, or what about them, or all of that. So all the whereabouts. So they told him three things. You're going to have a son, and you're going to have a grandson, and that son is going to be a knowledgeable person, alim. When he made dua before, said Allah gave him Ismail, and he said Ghulam Halim, patient. That's why when he was about to be slaughtered, he was patient. Halim is from patience, Hilm. But Alim is from Ilm, knowledge. Well, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us that Hilm, yani patience, there is part of it that natural, that Allah created certain people to be patient, above average, you know, they're more than anybody else. And there is a part that you get by practice. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما العلم بالتعلم, you become knowledgeable through seeking knowledge. وإنما الحلم بالتحلم, يعني you become patient by trying your best to be patient. Then it becomes a habit. They give him the glad tiding. So his wife came and listened to this. So she hit her face. How? يعني the woman said, you know, whenever somebody does something, they go slap their face like this. Natural reflex. So she said, Ya waylata, woe to me, Alid, I will become pregnant and give birth. In this age, they said that she was 90 at that time. Sayyidina Ibrahim was like 120. And that was normal at their time. I mean, a guy would live to, but after, you know, that age, there is no hope. So I am like that. فَأَقْبَلَتِ امْرَأَتُهُ فِي صَرَّةٍ And she's screaming. فَصَكَّتْ وَجْهَهَا She hit her face. وَقَالَتْ عَجُوزٌ عَقِيمٌ I am infertile and old. يعني infertile and young. Maybe miracle happens, right? But now I am infertile and lived all my life without giving child. And now I'm with a child in that age. Subhanallah. They said, that's how Allah Azza wa Jal wanted you to go through. In Surah Hud, he said, I am old and my husband is old too. So, and that's again showing us some of the nature of our sisters. So she does not want to be the only one who is carrying the issue. So she said, I'm infertile, everything, and my husband is old too. So yani, this miracle is not only because I am like that, and you know, my defect is not from me only, not from him as well. they said, Allah is Al-Hakim, Al-Alim. Always anything that happens, Allah Azza wa Jal has the ilm. How it's going to happen, when it's going to happen, why it's going to happen, where it's going to happen, that's ilm. Hikmah is what is behind that. Subhanallah, behind that glad tiding, all the prophets of Allah, from that moment until Sayyidina Muhammad, with the exception of Sayyidina Muhammad, came from Ishaq. So Ishaq is the son of Sayyidina Ibrahim. Ishaq is Nabi, he's prophet. And from Ishaq is Ya'qub alayhi salam. Is prophet also. من وراء إسحاق يعقوب. Yes, Ishaq has another children. But Ya'qub was the main. His name is Israel. And from Ya'qub came the 12 children. And from the 12 children, all the prophets of Allah. Until Isa alayhi salam was the last one. يعني Maryam is the daughter of Imran. وعمران هذا, Imran her father, from the offspring of Sidna Harun. Sidna Harun goes all the way to Yaqub Ishaq. يعني, this is the blessing. Hikmah, Hakim. يعني, she thought, oh, I'm 90, I'm old, my husband is this, but Allah has another plan. That all the prophets for guidance of mankind from that time will come from that son that you are wondering, I'm old and all that. So all these prophets come with the miracle of Allah, showing that it's not about old or young or this or that. That Allah will bring them from Ibrahim alayhi salam, no matter what, and from his wife Sarah, no matter what. They did not go marry another one and get all the. No, it has to be the miracle, bringing Ishaq from this old couple. This is something to ponder upon as well. Then after that, he said, what do you want? What do you want? So what are you here for? فَمَا خَطْبُكُمْ أَيُّهَا الْمُرْسَلُونَ And you come for, قَالُوا إِنَّا أُرْسِلْنَا إِلَىٰ قَوْمٍ مُجْرِمِينَ Criminals. Ijram or jarima means a crime. This is an answer for those who says there is nothing in the Quran says this haram and all. So what else have you want? Called fahisha. ما سبقكم بها من أحد من العالمين. You are doing a fahisha. The word fahisha is the worst of major sins. That it is not desired or not in the nature of humans. Everybody hates it. Dislike it, disgusting. That's the word fahisha. That's why we say zina fahisha. Zina fahisha. يعني zina, adultery, fornication is a fahisha. Fahisha means it is haram, but plus being haram, it is a disgusting act. Okay? Sayyidina Lut told his people that you having relationship men with men, that is a fahisha, يعني a major sin, and a fahisha, and above all of this, ما سبقكم بها من أحد من العالمين. يعني no one from Adam until you did this. And that's another proof that this homosexuality started by these people. Because some people here in the science and history, they say that this is from, you know, the history of humanity. The man has that desire of the same sex or whatever. That's not right. Because Quran says, Sayyidina Lut said, ما سبقكم. يعني nobody other than you, before you, did this. So that means it was something big. Something like, how we say, deviated. Something like perverted. Something like not human. They explored that. Why? Because they went away so much from Allah Azza wa Jal that they became enslaved to their lusts. And when a person is enslaved to their lusts, they want to explore things that people do not even think about. That's what happens. Even people will do, a'udhu billah, the worst things ever. As an extension to that. That's why their adab was like the worst of all. Not only they destroyed, though, Sayyidina Jibreel took them all the way to the heavens and screamed at them, you know, destroy all of them and bring them down to the lowest of the low. That is the punishment for those who do something other than how Allah prescribed, subhanahu wa ta'ala. They told Sayyidina Ibrahim they are criminals. So Allah called this fahisha or this sin fahisha. He called it a sin. He called it crime because the people who are doing it mujrimeen. Called it musrifeen, people who exceeded all the limits. Disbelievers, that there is only one house of believers were there, the house of Lut. That means everybody else is a disbeliever. And they were punished. Allah said they punished them because of that. I do not really understand where these people bringing their assumption now and said, you know, there is this imam, a gay imam, or this homosexual, or this. Where do they bring this from? Why you have to bring your personal thing and make it like, because other religions do that, because people do that? I really do not know. Yani, one of the major, major foundation of Islam is not to come out and reveal something deviated or some sin which is not according to the fitrah of Allah. Allah did not create us like this. This is something extra, something like coming out from the mainstream. And Islam telling us not to, and all the Muslims, 1400 years, Quran, Sunnah, 1400 years, consider this as a sin. And Rasulullah SAW said, all my ummah will enter Jannah except to those openly disobeying Allah Azza wa Jal. So that's why yani this debate, we do not want the people who do not have knowledge just to fall for it. Sin is a sin. And if a person who is homosexual, this is your test from Allah Azza wa Jal that you do not have desire for the other gender, whether you are a man or a woman. But it does not mean you act upon it. Everybody have desires. Who says that we do not have wrong desires sometimes? Zina is a wrong desire. Adultery is a wrong desire. Doing it with someone without the halal way. Or more than four, for example, if a man wants to marry. Cannot do that. If a person have that lust and that desire, whether a man or a woman, can they act upon it and justify? Say, because, you know, whatever Allah made halal for me is not enough and is not satisfying me. Would this be a justification to do the wrong? Same thing. And if Allah tested you and you could not resist, and Allah covered you, you are doing the wrong where you are hiding, why you come out? Why do you come out? And if they come out, why people support? Ajib, yani every sin brings another sin. Another sin, another sin. Someone have wrong deviated desire. That's your test from Allah. Allah Azza Jal makes someone aggressive. But say you do not kill, you do not do that. Someone who wants to take people's things, Allah said you do not steal. Yani shoplifting is haram. Some people have that disease. You cannot say it's a disease. Let them shoplift and then I'll pay for it. You cannot do that. People do wrong things. People steal. Islam tells you, do not steal from the thief either. So even you have a desire, a good desire to take back the money from the thief to give it to people, you cannot do that. Because everybody would become a vigilante, you know, like in their own. And that's not right. So Islam respects the privacy of the people and respects the main way that Allah intended. If someone deviate or drink or do this or that, and Allah covers you, repent to Allah Azza Jal, but do not come out and be proud of it, because it can take you away from the religion. If something Islam says it's haram, and you come openly and say it's not haram, become a kafir, wal'iyadh billah. May Allah save us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if a person is sinning, and he knows it is a sin, Allah covers, Allah forgives. This is something that I wanted to take this opportunity to emphasize on, and we should not be ashamed of talking about this. Anyone who comes across a person who identifies as a homosexual, it is haram in our religion. It does not mean I'm not going to give you a right as a student, as a teacher, if you are my teacher, as a neighbor, if you are my neighbor, as a co-worker, as a human being. I have nothing to do with your sexual orientation. This is your private life. Okay, you bring it out, again, that's your business. I don't agree, I don't like it. But you're expecting me to come and support you, otherwise you're going to label me? That's not fair. That's absolutely not fair. I'm not forcing you to be like me, and you should not force anybody to be. And they have people will be classified. Are they homophobe or they are not? Like, why? Why? This is unfair. Really, it's unfair. You know, reciprocate. Like, if you want people to recognize you, actually, don't ask them to recognize you. The whole idea, you are struggling to be by force, I have to be accepted. You know what? If you do not, people will not care. We do not care about your private sexual life. I don't want you to care about mine. Actually, I don't want you to know about mine. And I don't want to know about yours. So where is the whole issue? Subhanallah, I really do not know. And I'm telling this to my friends, Muslim or non-Muslim, you know, if you're going to hear this. Your personal, you know, this sexual relationship, our God makes it something to enjoy and cherish privately. He made it like between a man and a woman, there is a form, there is a template, there is agreement, there is a social presentation for it. But how it is taken care of, that's the most private, intimate thing that nobody should know except the two people who are involved in it. And that is the whole idea of it. And that's what makes it special and nice. Subhanallah. Part of the religion. We have even etiquettes for it. So for someone to come and make this the way that I should be identified, wallahi, I think we went lower than animals in this one. In my opinion, you know. I disagree, but this is my opinion. Like, why? Why I have to go and talk about the most intimate, private relationship in my life and tell people, oh, I'm straight, or I'm not straight, or I'm to this, or why? Like, you know, shaitan brings this thing and it becomes a war and a fight now. This is something that Allah punished the Qawm Lut for, because they openly did it, and they used to take people even by force, yani raping young men and all that. That's why they came running to Lut's house when these angels went to their young, handsome young men. And that is the reason I told you, I'll talk about it later. They came in the shape of fitna to them. That's what they want, but they are not going to reach to them because they're angels at the end of the day. Sayyidina Lut did not recognize them either. When he saw like these handsome people come and said, oh, now we're going to have a problem. And the bigger problem, that his wife was a culprit too. Like, she goes tell them, oh, there are young people at my husband's house, you go do your way with them. So they come in a gang, coming to Sayyidina Lut. He said, hold on, those are my guests. Please do not scandal me. They told him, you know, we told you, you cannot have guests, you cannot have this, that, this is what we do. And they're openly being proud of it. Like, you know, they're doing parades and stuff like that. So that's what exactly was the issue. He said, those are my daughters, you can marry. And some of the tafsir say daughters means the women of the community. Why you are avoiding the young women of the community? You do not want, and you become perverted and deviated like this. You see the sin, it causes what now? For the fulfillment of the lust, then the main idea of man-woman relationship was destroyed. Like, if people live like this, men with men. There is not, no result comes out of it except fulfilling their lust. There is no children going to come out of this. So after a while, the community will be destroyed anyways. The woman will get old, they will die, and there is no marriages, so no more children. So basically, this is going to become extinct. And that is one of the reasons why these people want to be recognized. Why? Because they want to be doing whatever they're doing and recognized as in the community. So they are not going to increase the community. They are not going to do that. But at the same time, they want to be dealt like everybody else. So basically, if they are isolated, it's not going to work because they've become extinct. So they just want to be part of it. And the right to adopt and the right to do this and the right to marry. Right? So it's all basically for other goals and objectives other than just, you know, to be free and, So Sayyidina Lut was scared. They told him, don't worry. Do not worry. They are not going to reach to us. We are angels. So they introduced themselves like they introduced Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. When they did not eat, he got scared. Now Sayyidina Lut, when he saw them like this, he got scared because they will come and take his guests. So they said, Lan yasulu, like, don't worry. Morning, tomorrow Fajr, you leave. Take your family with you and do not look behind. Anybody who looks behind, the Azab will take them. And his wife looked behind, so the Azab took her. Sayyidina Lut, of course, he believed in Sayyidina Ibrahim when he was thrown in the fire, remember that? And he went with him and he, went with him to Egypt. Sayyidina Ibrahim, when he migrated to Egypt, then he came back where Sadum is in Jordan, where the Dead Sea right now. So Sayyidina Lut, his two daughters and his family, they are the believers, but his wife was not. That's why Allah Azza wa Jalla said the worst example of those who disbelieved, the wife of Nuh and the wife of Lut. Their husbands were pious and righteous, but they betrayed them in the religion. So Allah Azza wa Jal says that they told Sayyidina Lut, we came to those criminals and we are going to send stones on them or punishment, and we trying to find who are the believers there. We did not find except one house, means Sayyidina Lut and all these people. And then Allah Azza wa Jal said that they punished them, and we left a sign, ayah, that the destruction for the people at that time, and there is a lake above them, which is Tabariya Lake, which is there, and it is now the area where they died as a sign. You will know that this is where the Adab of Qawm Lut did. Subhanallah, someone sent me one time a link for a documentary. I do not remember the name of the city, but a city in Italy, and they said it's thousands of years under a volcano, and it came and burned the people, and the people were in there committing sin, and they were burned, they're dried like there. They have like those statues, people go and visit and all of that. So Allah Azza wa Jalla leave a sign for people who disobey him. Worst thing is that you lose your life while you are disobeying your Lord. So it is a city of Pompeii, in Italy. So this is that section about Sayyidina Ibrahim and Sayyidina Lut alayhi as-salam. Then Allah says وفي موسى, and in Musa alayhi as-salam, when Allah sent him to Fir'aun with a manifest authority, yani Allah sent him with the hand. He said, Musa used to put his hand in his, like here, like from his jayb. This is jayb here, means the opening of the qamis. And he put his hand under his armpit. Janah, yani the wing. So some ayah said, وَضْمُمْ يَدَكَ إِلَى جَنَاحِكَ. So when he's scared, he will do like this, Sayyidina Musa, so he will become comfortable. And he will put his hand like this and will bring it out. It will become very shiny, light. He came with that sign to Fir'aun. and the stick, his cane becomes a snake. So Sayyidina Musa did this. Fir'aun tawalla biruknihi, he stayed in his corner. قال هذا magician, ساحر أو مجنون. Subhanallah, Allah mentioning this to tell Quraysh that you're not the first one who said to Rasulullah you are a magician or majnun. And there's a contradiction here, because a majnun, he cannot be a magician. A majnun cannot be a poet. A majnun cannot be a sorcerer. So when they said he is a sorcerer, he is a poet, he is a magician, those three do not gather together. Even if they gather together, a majnun cannot do any of them. So they contradict themselves. They say he is a magician or a majnun. How? How a majnun will do these things in order like that? Of course, Allah Azza wa Jalla here in Surah Adh-Dhariyat does not give us the full story, but in Surah Taha, Shu'ara, Al-A'raf, Surah Hud, you will find this story in details. Surah Al-Naz'at, even in Juz' Amma. So Sayyidina Musa is the one who is mentioned more than any other prophet in the Quran, in different aspects of his surah, different parts of it. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, he accused Sayyidina Musa, so Allah took him and his soldiers and threw them in the sea. So that means Allah Azza wa Jalla did not mention this story from the time he brought the sign to Fir'aun until the time that Fir'aun drowned. So, but here Allah is giving us the moral of the story. When they disobeyed, they were punished. Lut, when they disobeyed, they were punished. Musa, the people of Musa alayhi salam, when they disobeyed, they were punished. وفي عاد, people of Hud, إذ أرسلنا عليهم الريح العقيم, they were punished. The powerful wind that made all of them like hollow and dry. ما تذر من شيء, she left nothing at that time. أتت عليه لجعتك الرميم, made it like ashes. You know when you have like some structure, you put your finger like this and everything collapses? Collapses? That's exactly what it was. إلا جعتك الرميم. الرميم means this structure of sand or something like that. When you blow in it, it collapses all of it. So that's what قوم عاد, the word lift off of them, subhanAllah. That's why Allah said, كَأَنَّهُمْ أَعْجَازُ نَخْلٍ خَوِيَةٍ, like the trunks for the tree, empty from inside. Some tree, sometimes you find the termite ate it, so it's standing right there, but if you put your finger, it will go through it. And if you kick it, the whole tree will come down. That's how people were, like dry from inside, subhanAllah, from that powerful, strong wind. It is like nitrogen, liquid nitrogen or something. Yeah. It made them like that, subhanAllah.
And like a house of cards, they say?
Yes, but Allah Azza wa Jalla said, yeah, it is cold wind. رِيحٍ صَرْصَرٍ عَاقِيَةٍ. So it's a strong, powerful, blowing cold wind. So you can imagine like 150 miles per hour wind or something like a hurricane, but it's so cold it froze them in their tracks. وَفِي ثَمُودِ, قَوْم ثَمُودِ, قَوْم صَالِحِ, سَيْدْنَا صَالِحِ. So Musa, alayhi salam, his people are Fir'aun and Egyptian people, they died. And Ad, they are the people of Hud, alayhi salam. Thamud, they are a people of Salih, alayhi salam. إِذْ قِيلَ لَمْ تَمَتَّعُ حَتَّى حِينَ. Enjoy. You rejected, they killed the camel. Okay, enjoy. And the other surah, تَمَتَّعُ فِدَارِكُمْ ثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامِ. 3 days. Give them the warning. فَعَتَوْ عَنْ أَمْرُ رَبِّهِمْ. They disobeyed. فَأَخَذَتْهُمُ الصَّاعِقَةِ. Sa'iqa is the thunder, with the very strong sound. وَهُمْ يَنْظُرُونَ, they were looking. فَمَا اسْتَطَاعُوا مِنْ قِيَامِ, يعني they did not even could stand up. That's how it destroyed them. وَمَا كَانُوا مُنْتَصِرِينَ, even if they stood up, they wouldn't have win. They wouldn't have won this. Then وَقَوْمَ نُوحٍ مِّنْ قَبْلِ, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ. قوم نوح also, they were people who are rebellious against Allah سبحانه وتعالى. This brings us to the end of this section. And we continue, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, next time with Ayah 47 and onwards. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen and follow the best of what they listen to. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.